extremely pleased that I, for the first time on this long tour we've had, that I have enough time to present what I want to present to you more thoroughly. And I'm extremely pleased that Brother Tony did his thing and left me the time. We've been bonding over the last 3 weeks, and we do quite a nice duet together. I'd like to thank the organizers of this conference for I'm extremely pleased to be here. It's been quite a tour, and I've learned a lot. This work that Tony is doing is an amazing discovery for me, because I hadn't quite realized the importance of this book, in the sense that to me it was an historical book. We were dealing with an historical subject, but in fact, it is extremely contemporary. Because ultimately, it brings a lost history to today, where there is a huge Black African American, but Black African European diaspora living in this continent, living in Europe, living in Asia, and it now occurs to me how important it is to reconnect. Brother Tony, I'm going to use his own words. Now, I have to say this, because I don't appear like I'm trying to become a brother here. I actually am more than a brother, you think. I was born in Africa, in North Africa. I grew up in North Africa. I left when I was 20. And I was taken to Europe, believing that my roots were really European. And I got a bit of a shock. I got a bit of a shock, because that's when I really woke up to realize that I was indeed. I'm three generations in Africa. And I couldn't wait to finish my studies. I qualified as a construction engineer. And I took jobs back in Africa. Well, because I spoke fluent Arabic, my first jobs were in the Middle East. I don't like to use this word, the Middle East. I mean, it's like it doesn't. It's not in Africa. No, Egypt is in Africa. Morocco, Libya, Sudan. When I took my first job, I worked in many places in the so-called Middle East. And for those who may come from these areas, I had the fortune of working in West Africa. I worked in Guinea, I worked in Senegal, I worked in the Ivory Coast, I worked in Sudan. I love Sudan. I worked in the Wad Madani area, if any of you know a bit about the geography of Sudan, which is quite a difficult. We were diverting, in fact. I was responsible, or part of the team responsible for diverting one of the branches of the Nile called the Rahad to irrigate part of the desert. And then I worked in the Darfur, which I loved. I met the Dinkas. Many of my colleagues there were from southern Sudan. Anyway, I'm telling you this because all in all I've spent, I think, roughly speaking, about 35 years of my 64 years of life in Africa. So I think I qualify a bit like a half-brother. Actually, I'll go a bit further than this. Let's get to the root of this. We know now. It isn't theory. It isn't theory. What we know now, from pioneers in genetic studies, from some of the most illustrious universities, from Oxford University in England, Professor Oppenheimer, and many others that followed suit, that they have traced the matriarchal gene, the famous mtDNA, through the female line, and they've taken it down to one single woman in East Central Africa, which delightfully Oppenheimer named her the African Eve. It is she, whoever she was, that gave birth to the first modern human, Homo sapiens. It is a fact. It is no more a theory. Solid scientific investigation, which has been embraced by nearly all anthropologists or paleoanthropologists and genetic engineers. There's still a few, of course, who have trouble with this. But to cut a long story short, sometime around 200,000 years ago, this event occurred. And we know that 60,000 years ago, they remained for 40,000 years in East Central Africa, and then they started moving. And every single human being on this planet, the 6 billion plus human beings all over this globe, are originating from there. So even though I lived 33 years in Africa, I can say hand on heart that I and the whole human race, whatever their skin color, whatever their source, are all of a black African genesis. I'm not the one saying it, I'm promoting this. It has been said nearly 20 years ago. It has been confirmed in Nature magazine. It has been published in the Scientific American. And yet, it's still not sunk in. Because every human being on this planet is entitled to say, or will have to say, whether they like it or not, that they are originally from that source. And me? I'm a black man repackaged in Europe. That's what I am.
Repackaged.
That's all it is, really. Through a series of mutations, we have Chinese, but that is the truth. So, I suppose we can say, because I know this argument has been going on for a long time with Martin Berner and so and others, that in scientific terms, in political terms not so much, still have a problem, but in scientific terms, Eurocentrism is dead. That's it. No more discussion. End of story. What I'm about to tell you, and I've lost it, what I'm about to tell you tonight is this. And that's the work that I've been doing with my colleague, Dr. Thomas Brophy. I should introduce him, it's not fair, he hasn't been able to come here, but he was with us in Atlanta. And Dr. Thomas Brophy is a physicist. Professor of Physics, he worked for NASA. He is no lightweight. And he has put his name there on this book. Done the research independently, and we merged to produce this book. And this book says, and I hope we will run the point here, that when this out of Africa migration began 60,000 years ago. In fact, I tell you what is weird, is that Professor Oppenheimer believes that it was a small group, maybe no more than 150, that moved out north, up the Nile, through the Levant, into Europe. And the next thing you know, within 40,000 years, they were all over the place. But amazing when you think about it. One big family. It's so important because it drives the message. It's not finding your ancestral origins. It is finding the ancestral origins of this whole planet. And what a wonderful thing that it has brought. We are one big family. We're really brothers and sisters. However, there is one group, one very special group, that went northwest. Moved northwest and into the Chad, or the area we call the Chad today. Into the famous Tibesti Mountains, mysterious high mountains of the Chad. And stayed there for God knows what. We need to go back there again because this is all new. We know they were there. We found their remains. We found their images. And somewhere, we think, around perhaps 15, maybe 20,000 years ago, they descended down from the Tibesti mountain into the very corner of southwest Egypt, where today Egypt butts into Sudan and Libya, at this corner. I will show you the map. And there, at a time when that area, which today is bone dry, let me tell you, because I'll be talking about an expedition that I undertook to this area. It is, well, it actually was discovered only in 1923. We didn't even know it was there. You're going to see some images and you're going to be astounded. It's like going to the planet Mars today. In fact, NASA uses this area to do research because it does resemble an alien planet. And it is these people that as the climate began to change, slowly, slowly, as that fertile Sahara then became more and more arid, began to roam the desert, or what is the desert today, began to, sometime around 10,000 BC, perhaps 12,000 BC, thousands of years before the pyramid built. And because they had to move vast distances in search of water and to take along their food. We know now, Tony talked about the firsts that the Kemetians, the Egyptians did, calendar and science and astronomy. We know now that they were the first, another fact, to domesticate cattle. Before we gave this to the Asians, they were the first. We found the evidence, the carbon-dated cattle that they had. They domesticated cattle because they had to move. They had to carry their food, their live food. The cattle became walking larders. Drank the milk, drank the blood, and walked with their cattle. But they had to roam this vast distances, this huge area. Immense, what we call the Sahara today. And they had to know where they were going. And they had to know when they had to go. Because the water that they were seeking was temporary. The monsoons that still occur in Central Africa that caused the Nile to flood today would reach that northern part, that southern part of Egypt, and would drench the Sahara and cause temporary lakes. And these lakes would stay for a while and the water would sleep underground. So they had to know where the lakes were and they had to know when to go there. Because if you got there before, or after the waters, you were dead. Let me tell you, I did the trip. I took the adventure. I went to meet the ancestors. And since I've now said this, and we want a bit of encouragement here, Tony Browder and myself, and the man that was sitting with us, who is my publisher, who is a half-brother, by the way. He's married to a Senegalese lady, third generation in the United States. And we're talking about a project to write that book, that we hope your children and your children's children will have. Put the whole thing together. And we got a working title, as I like, but you see, we're calling it The Quest for the Ancestors. We're going to go questing. Really going to go to these aliens, the child, and we're going to quest. We're going to put it together. And having said this, they had to learn how to navigate. They were beginning to find themselves in a sea of sand. You're going to see it. Thousands of kilometers of dunes and rocky mountains and canyons and flat deserts. Flat, so flat that you can take your four-wheel drive, put it in gear, and sleep for an hour, and the car still is riding, and you hit nothing. Amazing. Huge zone. And to do this navigation, right here, they had to look at the stars. Like Christopher Columbus. Christopher Columbus did not invent navigation. We know that. We have the evidence of this. You're going to see what they left us. Amazing stuff. They left us the equivalent of prehistoric GPSs in the desert. We're going to go there. Before I do that, I want to raise the questions that were raised sometime about 15 years ago when we investigated, and I say we were a team of about four of us. Called us the four horsemen of the apocalypse, because we're really annoying the Egyptologists what we came up with. We came up with some strange, shocking results when we investigated the necropolis of Giza, when we investigated the pyramids of Giza and the Sphinx. Because the question that was raised there led us finally to find this ancestor. Giza. The picture taken from a balloon in 1872. The reason I know that is that the flood water that you see here, does not happen anymore. A barrage, a dam, has been built in Aswan, way up the south, and has stopped the floods. They still occur, but they don't pass down into Egypt. The pharaohs would have been really shocked with this. We interfered. That's what white men does, actually. They change the course and the cycles of the Nile. The sacred Nile, the pharaohs have gone bananas. Honestly, nobody was supposed to touch this. Three pyramids, you know them. I'm not going to go into too much detail here. Actually, I like to bring this up because to show you the scale of these monuments, and I'm not going to go through figures and numbers and all this, we don't have time. This does it. Somewhere in this picture, is the so-called Great Sphinx, Horem Achet, as we'd like to call it now, Horus of the Horizon. There he is. Like a dainty toy next to these giants. Let me tell you, the Sphinx is no dainty toy. It's the length of two city blocks, and it's high like a 15-story building. It's a big statue. In fact, it's the biggest carved statue in the world. But look at it. You can hardly see it, as a matter of fact. Doesn't it hit you? What's behind? I lived 3 years, from 2005 to 2008, in an apartment here. I've seen the pyramids from my balcony, from my office, in the daytime, in the morning, at dawn, at night, in winter, in summer, in clouds, in sunlight. And let me tell you, they owe you, they challenge you, they beg you to solve them, because they're like giant question marks out there. You go out there and you come up with your coffee in the morning. Who put this there? When? Why? You'd think we'd have the answers. Well, one of the great mysteries of these monuments, they do not contain any inscriptions. Nothing. Nada. Zero. Now, like Genesis, Robert Bavard and Dr. Thomas Brophy, PhD. If our publisher would say, listen, we're going to publish like Genesis, but we're not going to put your names in that. Yeah. Yeah. I get a bit sore. I mean, you're a bit pissed off, no? What do you mean? I've went to all this work, and you're telling me people are not going to know that I did this? They went through all this work, and they didn't even put their name on it. Isn't that a mystery? Not even the architect. He didn't even put a graffiti saying, hey, which is me. Who are these people? How come the pyramid is mute? That's what the Egyptologists say, the pyramids are mute. The Giza pyramids are mute, they don't speak. And yet we know that the ancient Egyptians loved to write. Boy, oh boy. If you go and see other monuments, at Giza as well, or in Upper Egypt and the temples, they're full of writing. Because of the temple of Edfu, you can spend years reading this temple. It's a book in stone. In fact, they took 20 years to actually copy the text and put them in translation. That's how much they love to write. The pyramids are mute. No, sir. They're not mute. As a matter of fact, they speak eloquently. They speak a very, very intelligent language. They speak the language that very intelligent people, people who understand that if you're going to talk across not space, across time, you're going to speak in a language that everybody, no matter who they are, if they're smart, you're going to understand. The language of science. These pyramids, in particular the pyramid of Cheops, has science in it. It's aligned perfectly to the cardinal direction. Within 3 arc minutes of a degree. 3 arc minutes of a degree. Let me tell you what 3 arc minutes of a degree is. I'm standing on the other side of the hall, and you put me a dartboard here, and you give me a dart, and you blindfold me, and I send the dart, and I hit the bullseye. That's how good I am. That's how good they are. Engineers today are baffled. How can you set a monument to 3 arc minutes of a degree without optical instruments? Without anything. We attribute nothing to these people. We say they didn't have the pulley, they didn't have the wheel, they didn't have iron tools, they didn't know mathematics, they didn't know astronomy. Well, yes, they did. It's there. It's so annoying. It's so annoying. So I came in the early 1980s, having seen these monuments. And every time I went there, I said, these are tombs, you know, and the fellow, they built tombs, and they were megalomaniacs. And I didn't see this. And the more I read about them, three Archimedes of a degree, precise measurements, the slope of the pyramid is so accurate, so precise, that you can be sure, whenever you measure the slopes of the monument, it is precise. I'm a construction engineer, my brother is an architect, let me tell you, we wouldn't know how to do this even with the optical instruments. And then they tell us, you know, they carry blocks, you know, 2-ton blocks, you know, 100 meters up. I've climbed the pyramid. I had to stop about 20 times before I got there, I was carrying nothing. You know, Egyptologists tell you this stuff as if it was okay, you know. Well, you know, can say anything, and you can write anything, until you test it, until you go there. They're even telling us stuff about the desert. They haven't been there. It's only when you're there that you understand these people. When you are in the desert and look at the stars, and you know why you're looking at the stars, you understand them. Brother Tony went there and he's there. He's digging with his own hands. I had the privilege of meeting the most illustrious, and not just meeting, he was my mentor, the most illustrious Egyptologist of our times, Professor Edwards, Sir Ivan Edwards, the curator of the British Museum, the man who brought Tutankhamun exhibition in England in 1972, knighted by the Queen. And he wrote about how the pyramids were constructed. It's about 4 pages at the end of this book. Today, if I was going to write about how the pyramids were constructed, and I don't even know how, I would fill a room full of documents. Have you ever seen a building project for a tower like the Millennium Tower, for example? Go to their office. It's full of drawings and specifications and engineers and calculations. You don't do this in 4 pages. Yes. You know, they put the stones and they put them up. It's nonsense. I'm telling you all this because there was something in my mind that I was a kid then. Something wrong with all this. You know, they've kind of made a consensus. They call this a consensus. And that's it. Everybody's sitting on this. Everybody's sitting on this consensus. That's what they are. Tombs, big tombs. That's it. I'd love to tell this story, and I think I have time, so. Yeah. In the 17th century, there was a man, a genius, called Isaac Newton. And he's sitting, minding his own business, probably sipping some drink, under an apple tree. And suddenly an apple falls on his head, boing. And he's the first man ever to ask the right question. Why did it fall? Why didn't it fly up? You think it's obvious, but it isn't. You think about it. Why are we not flying up? Why are we stuck on this planet? Because of something called gravity. He discovered gravity. He was the right man at the right place, with the right insight, with the right knowledge, and he discovered gravity, and 300 years later we put man on the moon. We are going to put man on Mars. We will travel to the stars one day because of this. He asked the right question. You all have an apple that's going to fall on your head, let me tell you. no matter what it is. Don't ignore it. Don't let others tell you to ignore it. Don't let the experts tell you, because that's what they told him. That's what he told Copernicus when he said the earth is round. And poor Galileo was actually taken by the Spanish, by the Roman Inquisition, shown the torture instrument and says, you've got to recount, this earth is not round. They set the fear in him. Because it's fear that stops people. And the fear, and yet, as he recounted, so this horrible torture incident, we pull his guts out and all that, and he walks out, and he says in Italian, "E pure gira." But it does turn. Truth is not democratic. It's the only thing that is not democratic. You can't vote truth. You can't bring a bunch of priests and say this is the truth. You can't bring a bunch of scholars and say this is truth. Prove it. Prove it. Bring the evidence. Show us. Don't take things for granted. How many mistakes have been made in history? And this shows that there's been a horrible, stupid mistake that involves you, all of us. So I'm getting a bit passionate here. I'm going to do better than Tony as well. I love his passion. But it's true. And we've lived with this mistake. And it's disturbed generations. You know that the Roman Catholic Church did not officially recognize that the earth was a globe till the 1900s? And it is only in the 20th century that they had to recognize that they committed genocide in the Crusades. What kind of truth is that? What does it take to shake these obstinate, arrogant experts that stop progress? Believe me, I lived it. I lived it. I'm getting a bit angry. Look at this image. I'm walking in the Cairo Museum in 1983. It doesn't take a rocket engineer, come on. It doesn't take a rocket engineer to say, yeah, okay, we've got one, two, three. We've got two equal sides. They run along a diagonal. This is the north-south axis, the meridian axis. Now, the meridian axis, the north-south axis, is the dominant axis of our planet, the meridian. And the entrance of pyramids are along the meridian, the chambers are along the meridian. The meridian is the big deal. And yet, they go there. Why? And then, more annoyingly, they set a third smaller pyramid offset. You see? You know this feeling when you're having dinner at somebody's place and you're sitting on the table and you're looking across the wall and there's this painting which is a bit like that. You can't wait for your host to go and make coffee and you go. Yeah, you can see the anomaly, we call these anomalies. Yeah, you wanna. Not only you want to do this, you say, wait a minute, why is it smaller? Let me tell you, this pyramid is not small. It is 65 meters high. 65 meters high. It's not a small pyramid. But when you put it next to the other two, people call it the small pyramid. Right? Why would the Pharaoh, who is supposed to be megalomaniac, they tell us, would want to advertise for posterity that he was small. That he was not as important as the other two. The architect said, King Menkaura, no. You are not as important as the two other guys, and all we can do for you is a small pin, and we're going to offset it as well. King Menkaura, the megalomaniac, takes the architect and says, listen, send this guy to the gallows. Get me another architect here. What's this? Right? But all this rubbish about King Menkaura and King Cheops and King Khufu, Cheops, King Khefren, Khafra. You know, they come and one says, I plunk mine here and I plunk mine there and I plunk a smaller one there. If you remove the ego issue, if you see this, and this is the leap of faith, the leap that you have to take sometimes. If you see this, and it's obvious, if you see this not as three individual pharaohs coming to plumb the pyramid on the same side. It is a project. It is one project. Menkaura did not have an ego problem. He completed a project. He was very happy to complete the project. So what is this project? Well, we said there's no texts. Fourth dynasty, supposedly 2500 BC, build these monuments, but no text, mute. However, you go to the fifth dynasty. Tony spoke about the fifth dynasty, that's where the texts were taken from, the pyramid of Unas. Remember? In the pyramid of Unas, there are the pyramid texts. At Saqqara, there are five royal pyramids of the fifth and sixth dynasty that we call pyramid-bearing texts. They are the oldest texts, religious texts in history. They are authentic. They are carved in stone. You can go and see them. They're not translations of translations of the King James Bible and all that stuff. This thing is the real thing. Well, what do they say? Get a translation and you immediately realize that it's all about the sky. No, more precise. It's all about the king having to undergo a metamorphosis. I was going to say chemical. To change his physical body so that he is reborn into an astral spirit, so that he can depart, he can ascend to the sky, to join and become the companion of Orion. Orion, Sahur, we have the annoying Osiris, the Greek name of Asahi. There is no doubt from these texts that Osiris is Orion. We have this evidence throughout these texts and many other texts from other generations. You'd think that this would induce our Egyptologist friends to take a look, rather than say this is hopeless pocus, you know, this is some superstitious priest telling us a lot of superstitious stuff. I like to say this because, you know what? It may be true. I'll tell you why. And every astrophysicist worth his beef today will tell you when he reads this, this is weird. Because that's what we think today with science. You remember Carl Sagan? When he did Cosmos? He said a wonderful phrase. He said, we are star stuff. We are star stuff. We are star stuff. This is no superstitious stuff. And now we know that in most likelihood, a star in the nebula of Orion blew up 5-6 billion years ago and came the bits and pieces and rotate around another star, our sun, and form the planets. And we're it. And they're telling us the same thing. This is really weird, isn't it? It's weird because you get the oogie-boogies here, I tell you. You get the oogie-boogies because it suggests something. It suggests. I'm not going to say it's true or not true, but it suggests that there is another way of knowing. There is the soul way of knowing. The knowledge is there. If we are star stuff, then it's all in there. From the very beginning of the universe. It's in us. We think we're discovering things out there, you know, the telescopes, and they're confusing us with black holes and antimatter and black matter, and you know, it's going bananas. Let me tell you, I talked to one of your famous cosmologists, Michikaku, you know, and you know what he calls it? He says it's crazy science. We're going crazy. Every time we think we're discovering something, it's blue. We're discovering stars that are older than the universe. It's like finding children are older than you. They're confused. They're trying to solve the mystery outside. And they're confusing themselves and confusing us. We need to seek. We are equipped to know. We are part of this evolution where star stuff become conscious of itself. What a wonderful way of looking at ourselves, because your ancestors said this, and they built their whole edifice, their whole civilization on that basis. And they called it Ma'at. The cosmic law. You are the descendants of this, an amazing pedigree. This is why it's so important for you, your children's children to connect with this thing. You have that pedigree thousands of years before they invented other religions. Weird religion. I'm not going to go into that. This is where it begins. This is the source of it all. And indeed, the Egyptians have a wonderful name. These Kemetians have a wonderful name for when it begins. They actually say Zep.
Tepi.
The first time. We're gonna hunt the first time. First in theory, then in fact. Are you enjoying it?
Yes.
I'm very silent, you know. Come on, give me some encouragement. Get them, clap. Actually, I'm enjoying this. I like when I have time. I like to do it properly because it has to. This is just a lecture. This is going good. That's why we get along so well. We actually go to it. We do it. We're just writing books. This is what it's about. And you can all do it. And the amazing thing is we both come from professions outside this. Because the established professions were so blocked. The great pyramid, the Mir of Mirs. For those who has been there? About very few, huh? I know you've been there, come on. We're looking through a, of course, graphic representation. Let me tell you, this is 1,000th reduced pyramid. Right? if we were going to draw it to the normal scale of architecture, we usually use a 1 to 500 scale, we would need a drawing that's about half the size of this room. My brother is an architect, says, well, how did they draw it? Because this represents 60 feet. You can't even scale it. You don't have enough little scales to scale. But anyway, let's go through it. You enter the north. Remember I said you enter the north along the meridian, and you descend to a subterranean chamber. Up here, there's a junction, and you ascend to here. Ahead of you is the Grand Gallery, or the name that Egyptology, the Grand Gallery. Tiny here, of course. It is 49 meters long. It is 9 meters high. It is a cathedral within a cathedral. And it is slanting. And it has stones of about 20 tons apiece. I don't know what Egyptology is going to tell us. I don't know how to build this thing inside a pyramid, surrounded by tons and tons and tons of stone. 6 million tons of stone to raise this monument. 6 million tons of stone. There is no contractor in the world who would take a job today with 6 million tons of stone. They wouldn't even know where to find them. I don't know if you saw this program, National Geographic, very annoying program they had about 2 weeks ago, where this guy tried to price the Great Pyramid. Did you see it? It's terrible. He ended up with a price for the raw materials. So.
How much was it?
Actually, he came up with one... Well, it depends, It depends what you're going to do with it. Like, he came up with 7 billion if you're going to bring in Central Park. They actually did a project to calculate what it would cost to bring it to Central Park so they could sell tickets. I'm not joking. This is a white man. They want to exploit everything. Honestly, the guy actually did a calculation on National Geographic to price what it would cost to bring the pyramid to Central Park, and they worked out how much money you could make out of it. Apparently it takes 15 years to break even and then you make a fortune. So you might as well invest, not in Wall Street, in the pyramid investment project. Isn't that crazy? This is not stone. This is a message from stone. This is a legacy. You don't sell this thing. You don't buy this thing. You don't price this thing. Everything has a price. Human life has a price. Well, oh well. I remember the Torah saying, come on, get to the Black Genesis stuff now. Yes, sir.
Come on, get to it.
Because I want to get you to the point here. You know, we live in a rush society, you know, we want fast food, we want fast answers. No. Our ancestors took their time. There's things you can't rush. You can't rush knowledge. You can't rush learning. It's a mistake. Anyway, in 1964, there are these shafts. Maybe I should go back one. These shafts from the so-called Queen's Chamber. I don't know if it was the Queen or not. The Queen's Chamber and the upper chamber, the so-called King's Chamber, and they shoot along the meridian. Southwards, 2 of them. Northwards, 2. The bottom one was known. I'll tell you the story later. It's very clear. Do not pierce the pyramid right away. And move fast on it. But in 1964, two researchers, one American, one Egyptian, Dr. Virginia Trimble, from Maryland University, and Dr. Alexander Badawi, who happened to be an architect and in Egyptologist, the right combination. Today we call the combination of an architect, an Egyptologist, and an astronomer, archaeoastronomer. We have a new profession. You need, I'm an archaeoastronomer. You need archaeoastronomers to study these things. Otherwise you miss the point. In any case, they discovered that the shafts in the king's chamber pointed to Orion's bed. The pyramid is not mute. It speaks. Look there. Look at Asaf. They didn't bother to check the alignment of the lower shaft. Here is where the so-called experts can be a lot of trouble, really, because they told them, nah, the lower chamber and the queen's chamber were abandoned. Why they were? Because they couldn't explain why there would be three chambers if it's supposed to be a tomb. So they had to abandon the other two. So convinced, and so convincing they were to Virginia Trimble and his family, that they bothered, it would have taken 5 minutes to check the alignment of the lower chamber. In 64. They had to wait till 1987, when I said, well, why not? And I checked it, and sure enough, it pointed to Sirius, the consort sister. Actually, you know what? They used to call themselves brother and sister when they got married. The term wife and husband does not exist in ancient Egypt. It's brother and sister. It's true. It's funny that you still use the same term. Yeah. And the pyramid began to speak now. I got very excited. It's telling us, look at this zone. They used to call this zone the what? The what? The land of rebirth in the sky. The place of Asa. On the banks of the Celestial Nile. Where is the Celestial Nile? If you were to strip the pyramid and see through, you would see this. At the time when it was built. Resurrection machine, I like this term. It's the hardware of a resurrection machine. It's the metaphysical computer of rebirth. And it makes you think they went to a lot of trouble to do it. It makes you think that maybe they knew something new. I came along and I've cut a long story short, which we're going to move now to Black Genesis. And I said, let's look at these stars. They're telling us, they're begging us to look at the stars. And what do you have? Big, small, opposite. The Orion correlation to you. This is published in 1987, and published in a book. I missed it in 1994. And boy, hell broke loose. The Egyptologists. They knew about the shafts. They knew about the texts. But they didn't like this. They didn't like this because it said that the Egyptians were far more sophisticated, and there's a message here. It killed this tomb theory thing. And I got called, you name it, I mean, Egyptologists, anthropologists, philologists, archaeologists, just about everybody who's got an ist after his name fell on my back. They didn't like it. Why not? And what they didn't like is this. Now we're going to move. If you take the date that is tagged by Egyptologists on this mark, and you compare the image, yeah, the two images look the same, but the angle that the stars form in 2500 BC is not the same. And you remember, you wanted to move the pyramid, now you want to, you want to turn them round. You can't turn the stars. Come on, that's it. Robert, you've got to stop here. I mean, you couldn't move the pyramid. Okay, you found the correct, but you can't turn the stars. You can't. Actually, you can't. You can, then start. If you are prepared to move beyond this date and look for this first time, the screaming first time, there is a wobble of the earth that creates a cycle of 26,000 years where the stars go up and down and up and down. We're moving. But the stars appear to go up and down and up and down and up and down forever in a cycle of 26,000 years. And the nadir, the lowest part, is what we call even today in astronomy the beginning of the cycle, the first time. And we have the stars of the first time, of Asar. Let's look at them. And when we did that, we go to 10,000 BC, 500 BC, it's the first time that they can't really lower. They not only go down, they turn. And then the Egyptologists got really mad here. Where, what? 10,500? No. In all our books it says 3,000 BC. 3,000 BC, there's nothing before. Just a bunch of maybe hunter-gatherers, and nothing. Where is the evidence? Where are they? Where are the houses? Never mind their houses. Where are the potsherds? Give me something. That was 1994. And it was true. Where is the stuff? Following me. Huh? Because let me tell you this, and I have time, brother. So I have to say. Because when these stars do this, you can do this at home. That's the beauty about it. You get an astronomical program, I recommend Starry Night Pro, and you do it at home. You put 10,000 BC, Cairo, it takes 30 seconds. It's very easy. User-friendly programs. Starry Night Pro, Redshift, all this stuff. The stars do this. They do it only when they cross the middle sky, the meridian, and they align with the pyramid, and they match what's on the ground as above, so below. They do it only at one specific time of the year. They do it every night, but it is, in astronomical term, we say, jargon, right accession 18 hours. Okay. What it means is when they are at the meridian, the sun at the vernal equinox, at the spring equinox, is rising. And when the sun rises at the spring equinox east, stars in the south, sun rising in the east, it rises due east. Not anywhere on east, due east. And anybody who's been on this site immediately says, kapow! Because there is another huge monument on the ground that is looking due east, gazing forever due east. And that's our friend, or it looks due east. And now the message in that bottle of pyramid, of Mir, is saying, what is he looking at? Is that it? What is he looking at? The sun rising due east. Interesting. Anything else? He's looking beyond the sun. He's looking. Let me tell you, when you visit this thing, when you go there at night, in the daytime, it spooks you. It ignores you. You are only passing by. This thing is looking at eternity. It's been there since God knows when. Looking at something. Waiting for something. Because what is behind the sun is the constellation of Leo. Horem Achet. Horus in the horizon. There he is. As above, so below. Long ding. This is the first time. Where is the evidence? We now go. Tony said, show the book. Look, if you don't buy it, so, but you've got to read this, honestly. It's Africa. Level, center, that's where it begins. They move, and they go up the Nile, and they go around, and they go around, and they go around. And once, look, remember, north, west, investing. Let's check this. I told you the end of the story, but let's really see it. Why don't you see it? Can I speak up?
Yeah.
Yeah, sorry.
No.
Oh, you can't?
No.
Why don't you come
closer?
Okay, okay. I thought I was shouting enough. Okay! Is that okay?
It's better.
Yeah, yeah. But actually, I like when people are close. You can move. Okay. Africa. We're going now to Africa. And we go to that corner of North Africa, which today we call Egypt, Kemet. And these are modern borders, right? Done by our European friends again. They came 22.5 degrees, we're going to call this year. We're going to put a border here between Libya and Libya. Actually, they've actually sat in a room in Germany, honestly, with all the heads of states of Europe, and they took this continent and they said, you take this, and you take that, and you take this bit, and the Italians took Somalia, and they divided it. Like some sort of pizza. Anyway, Egypt. Look at these names here, because they're a bit far away from you. There is a belt of oases that runs kind of parallel to the Nile. By the way, I mean, look at this land. It's actually a huge desert. It would have been totally uninhabited, there would have been nothing there if there wasn't the Nile. The Nile splits this desert, creates a huge western desert, it's attached to the Great Sahara, I call it the Egyptian Sahara, and an eastern desert. This is the bit that splits, more particularly here. More particularly here. And now we go to the adventure of discovery. The adventure of discovery. That's part of the fun, because we're tied to this, we're going to see, me and Tom Brophy. In 1910, a man called Hardy King, and he's an Englishman, from here, he moved somewhere here, it doesn't look like it, but he did 100 kilometers. 100 kilometers in the open desert is quite a job. 700 kilometers in the open desert, let me tell you, we did it. I'll tell you about it when we get to the end. Spooky stuff. But came here and he came across a hill. And he came across a hill and it was full of pots. And he named it the Pot Hill. No idea what it was. Abu Balas in Arabic. The Hill of Pots. There they are. Lots of pots. What were they doing? Comes another guy, very sexy guy here. It's called Hassanein Bey. I'm saying it all that because he was actually a very handsome man. He was educated at Balliol College in Oxford, spoke perfect English, was an Egyptian, and among many other of his exploits, he was a fencing champion for the Olympics. Among many of his exploits, he seduced the Queen of Egypt, had an affair with the Queen of Egypt. They say they married in secret, that's another story. He's kind of like a cross between Omar Sharif and Rudolf Valentino. I love this guy. I read a lot about him. Look how he looks. And he performed the most daring, the most amazing adventure in exploration ever to be attempted before and after. Well, the before, actually, wait a minute. No, you're going to see. Not quite true. On the coast of the Mediterranean, in a town called Salou, you remember this Libyan border where all the refugees crossed during the Libyan uprising? They crossed at Salou. He traveled 1,200 kilometers because he had heard from the Bedouins of some magical, mysterious Shangri-Las in the desert, oases that had wonderful things, and he set to find them. And he did. He found two. He found one here called Erkenu. Here it is, about here. And he found this zone here. He called it Ubaynat, the little eyes. Egyptian called eyes, pools of water. It's the only place in all this vast Sahara that you find water. It's not underground water. It actually sweats from the hills. This is the tallest mountains in the Sahara. Don't look like it, because it's a Google Earth. It's the most mysterious place you can imagine. I've been there. We're going to see pictures of it. But let's follow Hassanein, because, wow, it's supposed to be totally uninhabited. There was supposed to be nobody there. Nobody had been there. This is 1923. They couldn't go there because they said it was impossible to go there. And indeed, it was. You couldn't go from Egypt. It was impossible. You couldn't carry enough water on donkeys or camels to go there and return. Can't be done. It's a bit like taking a motorcycle and trying to go from Los Angeles to New York on one tank. Can't do it. How do you do it? How can you do it? Fuel stations, right? You need fuel stations. The donkeys need fuel stations. The jars, remember the jars? They didn't work it out yet. But Hassanein there, in the supposedly uninhabitable zone, camps with his guides. They made it. And the reason they made it is that they hopped behind Libya, managed to carry enough water because they were replenishing. And they reach this Jebel Ubaynat, and they sleep. There's nobody here. They find there's nothing. There's no living thing at all. And in the morning, he wakes up and he thinks he's dreaming. Because there is what he describes as a beautiful African girl with a bow. It's her, by the way. He actually took the picture. Huh? It's actually her with a bowl of milk. He actually says, because he wrote this wonderful report, you'll find it in the book, he thought he was dreaming. And she spoke a strange language. We know now it is Tebu, the ancient language of the desert dwellers. The Huron language, the Tebu language. And he had a guy that kind of understood, and she said, "Hello? Would you like some milk?" And he said, "What are you doing here? You know, I'm in Libya. How? You're here, I'm in that. You want to meet my king?" "King Harry," she said. Unfortunately, I realize we don't have a picture of him, okay? Hassanein actually took a picture of him. It looks really good. And she took him to her people. There was 150 of them. And King Harry said to Hassanein, through the guide, "What do you mean what we're doing here? We've been here forever. Where were you guys? You want to see how old we are? Let me show you the drawings of our spiritual ancestors. Our genes, they call them. Our spiritual ancestors." They took them, Hassanein was flabbergasted because there were these drawings. Look carefully. There are animals that should not be there. Giraffes and hippopotamus and elephants and lions. Animals that can only exist then and now, only 1,000 kilometers further south. Which proves what? That the Sahara was fertile. And with this information, he took it to National Geographic, and they went, "Wow, There were people there. You know these people that you saw in photographs? When they returned there 2 years later, they have gone. We don't know where they are. Maybe they returned to their origins. Nobody's ever found them. I've been there, believe me, there's nobody there. Or maybe they're hiding in the mountain. Don't think so. Who follows in the tracks of Hassan? Are you enjoying this day?
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
Get to it. You're going to meet the ancestors. Come on, I'm proud of you. You're going to meet them. You're going to meet the soul brothers and sisters. Who follows in Hassanein's track is another desert aficionado, prince, he's a royal prince of the Egyptian royal family, Prince Kamal ed-Din. You read about him in the book. And he had money, Islam. And he goes to the Ford company and he builds the very first four-wheel drive. Looks like this. They kind of put a tank and a 4T together and they made this thing. He had three of them built. By the way, because he was trying to go and see what Hassanein Bey found. He wanted to see with his own eyes. And he had three of them built. One is in the Cairo, one of the museums, one of the broken down museums in downtown Cairo, and two of them, we don't know where they are. The Egyptian government is offering $100,000 if you can find one, so that's enough reason to go there, no? You can sell it back to the Ford T for a million, to the Ford company. And he did the same journey, but from a different route. He went through the last oasis called Dakhla, and in the open desert he headed for Huwaynah. And little did he know that he was going to strike a mountain area dozens of times bigger than Jebel Huwaynah. Jebel Huwaynah is 30 kilometers long and 30 kilometers wide. He stumbled on this zone. It is the size of Switzerland, without trees, today. It is 300 kilometers long and 80 kilometers wide. And nobody knew it was there since until 1926. Kind of crazy. And the Egyptologists in those days said, there's nothing there. There it is. That's a picture actually taken by me. You are arriving like you are landing on Mars. Let me tell you, very easy. Extremely strange sensation that you're approaching this zone and you know there's been people there thousands of years before and you're approaching and we get the woogie-woogies. We get this feeling, man, wow. And it's unexplored. This man, an Englishman, found, oh, there he is with his other. He found just outside the zone. By the way, Prince Kamal ed-Din called it Gilf Kibir. It means the Great Wall. Great Wall, Gilf Kibir. And outside Gilf Kibir, on the north, the very first stone circle was found. It is 8 or 9,000 BC. It is still there. This picture is taken in 1936, and we went to see it. It is not just a stone circle. It is a GPS, a historic GPS. It tells you where you are, if you know how to use it. It is the GPS's left by those ancestors. And there's many of them. And one of the biggest ones we're going to get to, the most important. Comes this guy, Count Laszlo El Mashi, the real English patient. Remember the film The English Patient?
Yeah.
Right? That's the real one. He's nowhere near as handsome as Ralph Fiennes. But there was a real Lady Clayton, by the way. And Lord Clayton. He actually convinced him to come with him because they owned a gypsy moth plane in those days. It was very rare. And they brought this plane to Egypt And instead of going with these bizarre phobic drawings, they flew to give Philip.
That's the Philip song.
Hasanen, the Kamelik Dean, reported the position of this Gilf Kibir, but little did he know that it was full, full of rock art, drawings. And this time it's not just animals. This is actually pictured by, taken at the time, by Count Laszlo. And it is in a cave we call today the Cave of Swimmers. Remember where she dies in this Cave of Swimmers? We call it the Cave of Swimmers because you will see later pictures we took. But you actually see those black folks having a great time. They're actually swimming in what today is bone dry desert. Comes another crazy desert explorer. This time he's German. Carlo Bergman. I know Carlo Bergman. He came to Egypt. And when he saw the desert, he came to represent the Mercedes company. He came to Egypt, saw the desert, divorced his wife, sold his house, bought 11 camels, and went to explore the desert. He's still exploring. Great guys, huh? When you wander the Sahara, you stumble on Carlo Bergman. See a caravan, and you're going, he goes alone with his 11 camels. Amazing guy. And he broke the secret of Abu Balas. Remember this? Because what he found, you will see actual pictures of today. These are today's pictures. These are actually Carlo Bergman pictures. Here's the hill. And he found a whole trail. Fuel stations all the way. They were refueling their donkeys. But they stopped dead here. They didn't quite make it to Gilf Kibir. And the Egyptologists, even with that, said, No, they didn't really make it. We don't believe that the Egyptians can go there. Anyway, there was nobody there. He wrote a book. Here, these actual pictures of the jars. They're still there. I'll tell you one thing, because this is just telling you this. I really have to describe this. When you touch these things, and they're dead, it's an open air museum, I can tell you, the whole place. You go and touch them. And some of these things, they're not jars, but artifacts and grinding stones, and you touch them. You're touching something that the last time it was touched by human hands, by your ancestors, was 9,000 years ago.
Wow.
You are making contact. You know this fantastic feeling? I tell you, it's hard to describe. It really is hard to describe. This is why we want to take you there. It's one thing, no, it's another thing. Am I speaking loud enough? You gotta come. You gotta come and meet the ancestors. They're there. And you will see them now. The jars. Abu Balas jars. Here is Carlo Bergman. He took a bad, bad cold. He was with his camels in the middle of winter. The desert is really cold. And he was in hospital, and a friend of mine, Mahmoud Arai, who made the most stunning discovery you're going to see, told me, come and meet Carlo, he wants to see you, he read his book, and we all go to the hospital, and he's coughing and coughing, and he said, you got to go back to Munich. He said, no, I've got my 11 camels, you know, I'm going to take some antibiotics, and off I go. What an amazing guy. The last of the great explorers, these are the guys, not the guys with trowels and they go like this. These are the guys who do it. Everybody can do it. I tell you, this is great fun. It's terrific. You love it. Anyway, Mahmoud Barai. Mahmoud Barai is an Egyptian, a chemistry teacher. And he, like Carlo Bergman, said, but enough of chemistry, enough of students, I'm going to go and explore the desert. I need money, like all these projects need money. So he found a sponsor who was very keen. And of all people, it turned out to be a Maltese businessman, a fellow called Mark Borda, which you will read. Another amazing last of the explorers. He is wandering the desert alone to help humanity know itself. Great guy, confirmed bachelor. no house, not a lot of money. He made a fortune with a factory. No money, no wife, desert. And they went to Huaylas. They did a fantastic journey solo, one car. They never do this, but they took it. You want to take at least three cars, you got to get stuck in all this. And they went in the desert, and they were hoping to find rock art at Huaylas. And they crossed the Sudanese border, and they moved 50 kilometers to this zone, finding a lot of this rock art, you're going to see now. But what they found was the unexpected. That's hard evidence. That's when you really get the opposition. That's when you really get those who say it's not possible. You want to ram the evidence hard. But what they found was this. Pharaonic inscriptions of the old kingdom on the rocks. And you know what they say? They're for King Mentuhotep II. And they say, we came to meet the ancestors. We came to meet the people of Yam. Two places. It's the Yam and Tehebet. We had heard of Yam in other texts, but Egyptologists were so convinced that nobody could get there that they said, no, the Egyptians, they speak of going in the desert, but they really went up the Nile. And the Yam is somewhere in the Sudan, somewhere distant there. No. They went there in the south extreme of Egypt to Huaylas to meet their ancestors. You want to see them? Let me get a cup of water like
you're doing all right.
I'm learning from you. We call this the pregnant side. Oh, we let you sort of go. On their way back, they found a prehistoric cave. It is today called the Borda Cave. Markborg. It is the Sistine Chapel of the Sahara. You there? Mm-hmm. Let's not mince words here. They're black African people. Wonderful. This is just one picture. Thousands of pictures. Look carefully. A lovely sister sitting down doing something, wearing some amazing headgear. Or you see it here?
Mm-hmm.
She's in a house. This is 9,000 years ago. Long before anybody did anything. No pyramids, no Greeks, no zilch. They're in houses. And they have decoration and gourds. And some of them are working, others are doing all sorts of things. Look at this guy, he's wearing what we call an Egyptian toga. They dress like the Egyptians dressed later on, thousands of years before. He's wearing some sort of headgear, you see it? They're wearing jewelry. Look at the quality of their art.
Oh my.
9,000 years ago, artists. When we entered this cave, I did. I was the first to enter after they discovered it. You think it's not possible. It's as if it was painted yesterday. When we send the pictures to magazines, they said, you're kidding us, this is just fake. You know how we know they're old, that old? Because when they did those paintings, bees used to come because it was humid and they would have their nest. We can carbon date the bees' nest. Isn't that clever? I just had to go there and see this, right? I mean, you have to go can't see this. And so we undertook an expedition with Mahmoud Barak. I tell you what I wanted to see, because you know, I'm one of those guys, I have to, I'm St. Thomas here. I was worried that maybe the photograph they took wasn't quite, you know, I don't know. Let me go and see this. We undertook an amazing journey in 2008. Thomas Brophy, Dr. Thomas Brophy, myself, and six other people, including the support team. We had two women with us. It's possible. Now let me tell you, if you ever think of doing this trip, it's not five-star hotel. You don't wash for 12 days, ladies. But we had two ladies and they had a ball. They loved it. One of them is my wife. And my wife has that, she's French. She spends an hour in the bathroom every morning. But she loved it because the thrill, you know, you're doing something like that. Traveling in the unknown. That's the feel, huh? This amazing silence and sleeping at the dunes. And we stopped first at one hill that Carlo Bernal had discovered, 100 kilometers from the oasis of Dakhla. And I'm looking at inscriptions. And they have the name of, you're gonna love this, King Khufu, builder of the Great Pyramid. And his son, Djedef. And they say that they send envoys to this place to look for some mysterious stuff called Mofat. We don't know what it is. We read about it. There's a whole mystery about what this Mofat is. King Khufu was very keen to get this stuff. But next to his inscriptions, you can't see them too well here, but it's full of them, were the drawings of the ancestors. Pharaonic ancestors together. They knew each other. We now know from a reinterpretation of the pyramid text, because we have this information, you know what they call them? They call them the spirit people. People of the land of the spirit. The soul people. Isn't that nice? You read how we interpret this. People of the Achet, wrongly translated as people of the horizon. We did a whole job here. People of the Achet, people of the spirit people, the soul people. Amazing. And we move, we go, and we are now in the cave of swimmers. 7 kilometers in the deep desert after 5 nights of traveling in the open desert. We kind of stayed apart because we begin to stink. I had this t-shirt unchanged for 6 days. We're limited how much you can take stuff, by the way, because we give priority to water and fuel, of course. Those are the main ingredients. The rest is, never mind about the food, you know. Never mind about the toothbrush. You know. And when the cave was swimming, there is Tom Brophy, by the way. He was so excited. You know, when you've traveled 5 days in the open desert and finally get there, and we slept in the cave of swimmers, we sleep where the ancestors were sleeping. Well, wow. I tell you, it's great stuff. The stars passing through, it's like a natural planetarium. It's kind of oval shaped, and you sleep in there and you see the stars passing, and you, what? I tell you, I'm not one of these guys who thinks, but you almost hear the presence. Time goes away. There's no more time. You are there, and you feel them. You hear the wind through the rocks, and you see them. And you know what? The amazing thing is there is not one scene where they show any sign of aggressivity. They're having a ball. They're swimming, they're dancing, performing rituals, they kiss each other, they hug each other. There's a fantastic scene where they're all holding hands. They were cool. They are you. And then we go to the mysterious woman. The mysterious, oh, why not? Somebody's saying, we're there and it's late. And Mahmoud Arai said, no, 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 you don't want to get there at night. You can get lost easy. And the urge to go there, the urge to land on this place. So we camp and we spend the whole night, nobody could sleep. We spend the whole night around the campfire and we're talking. You can't believe the conversation we're having by then. And we're talking about eternity and the stars and the past and who we are. You really get into it here. You make contact. And there's Mahmoud Arai pointing to this rock, and it's there. The inscriptions are there. You see other pictures in the book, so I'm skipping. But okay, you see them. But are they the ones who really went to the Nile and created the pharaonic civilization? Naptaplai. I'm okay on time, though.
Yeah, you're good.
Naptaplai. Naptaplai is the key. Naptaplai is the evidence. Naptaplai is what will change and has changed everything. Because there is the evidence that these ancestors are the originators of the pharaonic civilization. I want you to remember here, I'm going to show you the picture, I want you to remember. Remember the pyramids. You remember their message. And Orion and Sirius and 10,500 BC, and this is the first time, and all this. It's a message for us. Go and look for the ancestors, because you will see. Now this is what happened in 1974. Actually, strange enough, as fate would have it, was Sheikh Anta Diop was giving his famous conference in Cairo. And when he produced all this evidence, melanin, linguistic evidence, and they poo-pooed him. They sent him away at exactly the time when he was doing this. A group of American and Polish anthropologists, calling themselves the Combined Prehistoric Expedition, from the Polish Academy of Science and the Methodist University of Texas, led by two giants in anthropology, Professor Fred Wendorf, who is retired now, and Professor Robert Schill, who is in Warsaw, correspondent in Boca. We read about this here. And they had a team of students. Like Brother Tony takes students, and they were exploring the desert. They knew there was prehistoric artifacts. The desert is full of it. But what they weren't expecting is this. And by luck, this is an amazing thing, because you can find the same thing. There's lots of things we don't know yet, but they stopped at this place, which they eventually called Naptaplai, and they stopped where they politely said in the base article for a comfort break. They stopped to have a pee. Right? And we don't know who said this, but somebody said it. Whoa, 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 whoa. And there was massive stones all over the place, and artifacts, and conglomerations of stones, and things that looked like igloos, all over the place. 777 kilometers long, 2 kilometers wide. We call it now the ceremonial complex of Naptaplai. There was no people there. They didn't find people. They found where they gathered, a bit like Stonehenge in England. They came to this place. to do something. What they did left us the evidence. The left, doesn't look too much here. I like to compare this to something because a lot of people said when this was announced, it took, this is the weird thing, Tony and I are mystified by this. They discovered a place in 1974 and they didn't realize that this had astronomical qualities till 1997. And in the book you have a quote from Professor Edwards said, it's amazing how we saw this place but we didn't really think about it. But finally they got this astronomy down. A fellow Kevin Balvin from Boulder, Colorado University, and he immediately realized that he was looking at an astronomical site, and he called this the mini Stonehenge in the desert. It may be small. It is several thousand years older than Stonehenge. We know that because we carbon dated the stuff around it. It is at least 4,000 to 5,000 years before the build. But that's what the anthropologists were baffled at first, is when they started excavating these tumulus, they were surprised. They thought maybe we're going to find some bodies under there. What they found were two things. You can find the pictures in the book, but one of the mysterious things they found is they found that these people, and we don't know why, moved massive stones, like the pyramid builders, and they buried them 3 meters underground. They carved them in strange shapes. Here's one of them. One of them we call the cow stone. It kind of looks vague. You know why we call it the cow stone? Because in other places, we found cows buried. Cows buried, complete, in ceremonial setting. They all look south and they all have beads, and very clearly they had begun to develop, maybe they had already well developed, a Hathorian cult. The cult of the cows, but the cult of the stars. Huge stones all over the place. This one you see, look at the car. 25 to 30 ton blocks move in this desert. Here's the mystery for you guys to take over. We still haven't physically found the people. But there, somewhere, the tombs unfound. Not one. Because they went away. The stone circle. Look where it is aligned to. Orion is best.
Wow.
They were tracking the 3 known constellations of the pyramid builders.
Wow.
Orion's Belt, Sirius, and the Big Dipper. Remember? They were doing this thousands of years before, and they weren't just aiming at them. They tracked them over the centuries. We have a center point where they shot lines of stones like spokes out of a bicycle wheel towards the north, towards the east, and they follow Orion's Belt over the centuries. They were following the precession of the equinoxes, which to this day the scholars attribute the precession of the equinoxes to the Greeks in the first century. In fact, it seems that the whole history of the ancient Egyptians has been plagiarized by the Greeks.
Yes, they have.
Yes, they have. Yes.
And we wanted
to stolen legacy.
Give us back our pyramids. Give us back this. And I'm saying give us back this because you know what? You're not going to believe this madness. They took away the stones.
What?
They did! And they took them to the Nubian Museum. And they messed up the alignments. Honest. And you know what else? They want to flood the area. They want to flood the whole area. Do irrigate the desert, they tell us. Are we going to let them?
No.
No. We've written to UNESCO, we've written to the Supreme Council of Antiquities, and this is madness. Apart from the madness of trying to irrigate a desert that's been bone dry for millennia. Because you put water there, let me tell you, in the summer, you come to five and it's gone. It's wasted. It's a crazy project. You know why this project exists? Because a lot of people make money off it. It's like moving the pyramid to Central Park. They want to exploit the desert. They're not happy having a desert. They want to actually make money out of it. And what? To hell with these origins. To hell with this legacy. It's time to get angry, like in Wall Street. I'm getting angry. I'm a nice guy. Enough of this madness. It's priceless. It is the land of the ancestors of the human race.
Yes.
Tony, that's why we're getting together. Can't fight this alone.
Right.
Need help. Need voices. We need voice. Here is me measuring the alignments. Here is, let's go, here is measuring the solstitial alignments. You can't believe the feel of this place. They had clocks, sundials, long before the Greeks even thought about it. The Greeks weren't even existing. They weren't even living in caves then. It's true, I'm not sort of throwing this around, this is true. It is me in the middle of summer trying to... How did they do this? Let me tell you, I'm huffing and puffing here. I wouldn't move a 2 kilo stone for 10 minutes, let alone a 25 ton block. Look at this. And you know what? They've even moved these stones to decorate the garden of the Nubian Museum. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we've got about 20 minutes for Q&A. Questions, can we have questions instead of mini lectures, our sister?
Actually, just a little comment here, you mentioned Libya. Libya, there's a war going on there.
Yes.
And luckily it's now falling in the hands of some apparently reasonable people. It's important because the Libyan desert is the Greater Sahara. And it's full of these things. These people didn't just roam the Egyptian Sahara. They went all over the place. They went to the sub-Saharan of Mali. You read in the book. These were navigators, big travelers. Thousands of years before the Greeks even invented a boat, let alone a ship.
Well, that's why the spirit did not say Egypt. It said the land known as Kemet. Set the energy there because it's bigger than what we
understand.
So thank you for the wonderful answer.
It's my understanding that when the pyramids and the pyramids were done and these monuments they were aligned with the heavens, and that's where the 23rd Psalms comes from. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven, and the Lord is my shepherd, meaning the king with his staff and his shield to comfort them.
Well, you have a point in the sense that what we're looking there is the what we call the Hermetic axiom, the as above, so below. But I don't want to take it away and say it is the Hebrews or the New Testament, who, because we know it was there in ancient times.
But it was there. I'm saying it was there before. That's been plagiarized.
Yeah.
They took all this. Like you said, you couldn't even stay in the desert and build anything. Neither could these the Hebrews or the Jews. It's all a lie.
Okay.
It's plagiarized.
Let me just say this statement. So real today. I was in Wall Street yesterday. There's a lot of angry people there. They are a bit confused as to what they want to achieve. It's true. But you know what they have in common? They're pissed off with the system. Pissed off bad. They're pissed off in Egypt. They're pissed off in Libya. They're pissed off in Syria. They're pissed off. Because what? The system has created a system that is conning them. You're a person who worked all your life and you pay your taxes and you pay your Medicare and you find yourself, your house is possessed and you're in the street. What's the system? The ancient Egyptians had math. They didn't listen to man-made systems. They listened to the law of the cosmos. They listen to the universe. They listen to the inside law. The law where man is united with his land and that they all progress towards justice. They all progress towards this amazing concept of math. And they lived harmoniously. We've seen them from 10,000 years now, we can see them. Untouched, harmoniously, wonderful art, wonderful exploits, the pyramids, the temples, all this. Until who came? The Romans. The Romans came and the whole thing went pear-shaped. And you know what they did, the Romans, like Romans, Italians? They exploited Egypt. They took everything it had. That is the truth of history. And worst of all, and this is where the Tony comes into play, sorry, I'm kind of getting hot here. Worst of all, they took your history. Because it's okay to take your stuff, but if they take your history, they've taken your soul.
Right.
And now, we're not going to let this happen. People are working hard to bring this out in the open. We don't want just this group here. We want the whole world to say, this is the real history. Enough. That's it. Come on, that's what it is. Right, Tony?
All right. You know, let me just say this too. Traveling with Robert in Atlanta 2.5 weeks ago at the Nile Valley Conference, Dr. Lena, my colleague, who found the tomb of Kuakamon, was invited to come over to the conference. Tom Brophy, the co-author of Black Genesis, as well as Robert Sharp, who did the dating of Hermocke and the Sphinx. Four white folk, right, in the midst of black folk at this conference. Never been exposed to these many black people talking about history in this context, and it was transformative for them. They don't know what we don't know. Even they don't know. But what was interesting is to get feedback from them as they listen to Dr. Finch, as they listen to scholars from Senegal and from Ghana and from Mali. As they heard the truth, I mean, it resonated with them. One of the things that we're confronted with right now, Robert's got a new book out called The Master Game, and it deals with the game that is being played on everyone all over the world. And what it requires is that we're going to have to begin to wake up and start acting with a sense of purpose.
Exactly.
A sense of purpose. We can't just talk about things that happened and not do anything today. The only way people can exploit you is if you remain silent and ignorant. You have to act, but you have to act with forethought.
Right.
You know, the times in the 60s when we got upset and burned down our own neighborhood. No, we need to use different strategies this time because times are changing. The world is changing. And if we really believe that we are connected with our ancestors of thousands of years ago who set the world in motion, who set society in motion, we have to know that that same spirit, that same energy, that same consciousness is in us. And that by grounding ourselves, centering ourselves, and acting on what is inside of us, we can change the world again. Let me get to my sister here and then go to Dr. Simone.
I just want Dr. Bobal to clarify what was found in the King's Chamber through that small door. I don't think people here may know that little piece.
Is that
piece true or what?
Well, yeah, they found the door. Yes, it's absolutely true.
But what's behind the door?
Well, but I share with you about...
I have to be clear on this. Because there's been a lot of rumors and what's been found and has there been secret explorations and all sorts of stuff. I have been at the very origins of this project with the discoverer of the first door, Rudolf Canterbury. I'm actually the person who promoted Rudolf Canterbury's discovery in the international media. You probably will read all this in my book, The Orion Mystery, and in great detail, if you can find it, a book called Secret Chamber. The whole story is told there. Secret Chamber.
Secret Chamber.
Yes.
Yeah, it's one of my fun books because it goes through the whole story, whether there is or there isn't secret chambers there. And I hope you can at least take me on trust on this. I do good research here. I'm very, very careful at how I researched it. And I will tell you the truth. A door was found in 1993 in the southern shaft of the Queen's Chamber. I was instrumental, by the way, in finding artifacts that were found in this shaft in 1872 and got lost. You read about it in my book, in many of my previous books. So I've been very involved with this thing. And from 1993, there was a huge, huge political game, the game, one of the games, and they stopped poor... I mean, you can imagine you're the guy who found a door inside the Great Pyramid and he spent $250,000 building a robot and then you are prevented from looking behind the door. Can you imagine what this guy felt? I knew him. He was my, really, we were very good friends. And he's tortured by this. He can't believe the blockage that he had because it was not until 2002. Can you believe it? From 1993 to 2002, that finally when they got him out of the way, you know why they got him out of the way? Because they want to exploit this door. They want to sell it. They sold it to National Geographic, who made over $150 million when they did their famous show live in 2002. They think like that. And we're still waiting. And what National Geographic found, they drilled a hole in Canterbury's door and they found a second door behind. Then they explored the northern shaft and they found a similar door like Canterbury. This door is very weird. Actually, I have images of it, but we don't have time. You want to see it?
Yes!
Yeah. Actually, I finished 15 minutes before.
I'm not sure which one it is. I've got the file. The
file called Shaft Story. The file, not image.
No, I don't know if I have that one. I don't know if you gave me that.
Shaft Story.
That's a nice
picture. I will be brief here because we don't want to go through another lecture. But I want you to see this because you asked the question. And it is, believe me, if you think the pyramid was mysterious, these shafts in the pyramid are the most mysterious thing you can imagine. We're going to see them now.
probably comfortable in.
Yeah, I'm gonna move fast here, and Tony's gonna help me.
Okay, while you're looking, I went down under the Great Pyramid, saw the empty sarcophagus. The great one.
The second one.
You go down straight.
Yeah, the second pyramid.
The second one, yes. And where is that? Where's the body that was? Is that in the museum?
No. There's never bodies ever found in the pyramids. That's a good question. Sorry, you should have said this. One of the mysteries of these supposed tombs is that not one single corpse has ever been found in any pyramid. No, better still, we haven't found corpses of the 4th dynasty. This
question.
Tomb theory doesn't work. But anyway, let's go to the room.
Shots.
That's Here's the shaft that Rudolf Ganterbeck explored. It was actually discovered in 1872. The shaft did not break through the room. So nobody knew it was there. And when in fact they opened it in 1872, they found this little object. You see pictures of them. In fact, I've got a picture of one of them, but never mind. And then, let's go to the inside. Here is the inside of the shaft. Look, I tell you this. Because I like this drama because it's true. When Rudolf Ganterbeck called me up and said, I found a door inside the Great Pyramid. Actually, it was the 1st of April. I thought, come on, you know.
Yeah.
But he said, no, I've got it filmed. It's on VHS in those days. I'll send it to you. And he sent it by DHL. I actually went to pick it up. I had to see this thing. I put it in, and we're sitting there, and you see this. He called it a journey into the unknown. Nobody's ever been there, not even the pharaoh. It's too small. And this robot was waiting. Did you see that these programs where we show this?
Mm-hmm.
Huh? And it comes at the end and he finds the door. How do we get this door?
Oh, I get it. Right here. Mm-hmm. You want this one. Okay. Oops. What is this?
Yeah, we have to move slide by slide here. When I saw this for the first time, oh, thank you. When I saw this for the first time, when anybody saw this for the first time, after 4,500 years and maybe 10,500 years, probably no, we were there at the entrance to God knows what. Now, come on, this is the Great Pyramid, the greatest monument ever. The most mysterious structure on earth, and this guy finds a door, and they wait, what, 13 years? What's wrong with these people? I mean, they must be the most unexciting people in the world. I'm talking about being patient.
Who are the people?
The Egyptologists.
Just them? What about their hosts, the Arabs?
Well, we don't know. I mean, it's an amazing story. Well, actually, let's name one person. Dr. Zahi Hawass.
A criminal.
Yeah, he's actually going to be arrested pretty soon. No, I'd rather say the ex-minister of antiquities, Dr. Zahi Hawass, who is now in house arrest because it delayed. You know why? Because they were hyping it. And then when Zahi Hawass became director, head of the Supreme Council in 2002, National Geographic came to him and said, give us exclusivity, because we can make a fortune out of this. And you know what? We're going to make you explorer in residence. Not only, wow, explorer in residence, National Geographic, we're going to give you $250,000 for life per year.
Wow.
Oh, my
was in the New York Times.
Oh,
we exposed this a couple of weeks ago, no?
Wow.
Yeah, that's what brought him down. You know, when his employees found this out, when they haven't been paid for months, and he's telling them we don't have money?
Oh my God.
Exploitation. It's a race of exploiters. They've stripped these things out of their soul. We want to know, we want to, their wisdom, we want to understand them. We don't want to sell them. We don't want to bring them to Central Park. And keep National Geographic out of it. Rupert Murdoch. He actually bribed the British papers to do what? Come on, you guys, have you followed that story? For his reporters to interview people who survived 9/11 so they could get exclusivity on the story. It's horrible. Enough of this exploitation. And the pyramid was passed on to National Geographic. That's the truth. And I'm getting angry because I don't normally talk like this. Honestly, I don't. You know? I'm a nice guy. But I am angry. I'm like Wall Street. Because I've heard enough. Come on, I'm going to use the word. Can I? I've heard enough bullshit. Telling us this and telling us that, and we will save the monuments and we will restore the monuments while they were making money, and we believed it. It's like Wall Street bankers. Greed. And now is the time, guys. Now is the time, because the reins of Egypt are loose. We don't know who's going to be this government. And the desert that contains this amazing legacy is for the taking. Now, we've been talking about it. We want to join forces, we're going to talk to universities, we're going to find the right people. We want this desert to be allocated by permit so that we can explore it properly. Not to sell it. So this is your answer. And the truth of it is that, honestly, we don't know what's behind the doors, but Hawass brought another team just before the revolution. And they published in Nature, in Science, American Science, inscriptions. And they're still trying to work out where it is. But, you want to see the inscriptions?
Yeah.
Get your water.
It's right here.
While he's doing that,
yeah. Here's a composite photograph. You see them? See those red marks?
Mm-hmm.
They're inscriptions with poker. What does it remind you, by the way? Huh? The rock art you saw in the way, not? Huh? And they're very mysterious. Very mysterious. Can't find. And some hieroglyphians said it belongs to a different language.
Different what?
Language. And another one, an Italian mathematician, found the language of science. He says, no. They are numbers. And when he managed to decipher the string, he found the number 121. 121. 121 is 11 times 11.
11.
Hold on. The square root of 11. The pyramid is designed by that code to find 11, the square root of 11 in all its design. You know what? It is the distance of the door to the chamber. It's a code. And now we're waiting here. And we ask them for the original pictures. These are actually the pictures, but we want high resolution. And we want publications. And they've gone again. And the whole thing is back into this darkness of confusion.
I've been on this trail, so this is the latest. Now, I know there's many Rubens, they look behind the door, they found the statue, they found this, and they found that. It's not that. I mean, I wish they had. Yeah.
Were you part of a group who formerly wrote Fingerprints of the Gods, Graham Hancock?
No, not me. I wrote many books with Graham Hancock, but I did not write Fingerprints of the Gods.
Well, I'm not saying you wrote it, but my point is that those group of authors were refuting that the ancient Chemites or that any humans could have possibly built any of the pyramids that was on Earth. And that it had been aliens, people from out of another planet?
No, sir, I'm sorry. No, sir. You will never find the word alien in any of Graham Hancock's books or mine. In fact, I deplore who says this.
Excuse me?
I deplore who says this. Hey, the Greeks wanted to take your history, now they're going to give it to aliens? No, sir, I'm sorry. It is built by human hands.
No, but I'm saying you never propagated that at no time whatsoever in history.
Never read my books. But who has propagated this is Dr. Zahi Hawass.
Yeah.
He even talked, Dr. Thomas Brophy, a scientist from NASA, and he called him a charlatan who propagates alien theories.
Yes.
Come on. They've been playing rubbish. It doesn't work anymore. You know why? You remember this film network? You remember it? Huh? When, what's his name? Peter Finch is up there with the god of the corporation, and he says, why me? And he says, because you're on TV, dummy. We beat them at their own game here. I've been on BBC, on NBC, on Fox Television, on this, I'm actually on Discovery Channel on the 19th, watch it. How about this? They don't know where to look anymore. And Graham Hancock has been, and John West, and Robert Schock. We're swamping them. We're no more these guys behind the desk that they can say the charlatans and pyramidians and pyramidologists. Dr. Hawass is in house arrest, and I'm here talking to you. We're exposing all this rubbish. And you know what? I'm the only one to tell you about this. I'm the only one who promoted Rudolf Gantry. I'm the only one who published this. Not one single Egyptologist lifted a finger to support Rudolf Gantry. It is a disgrace, because they were afraid that Mr. Dr. Zahi Hawass would not give them licenses to work in Egypt. You've got to overcome fear. You won't be able to stand here and call the shots.
Isn't religion behind the whole cover-up? All three Abrahamic religions behind the whole cover-up? All these people have religions. They go to church. The Jews, the Christians, the Muslims. They don't want any of this to be known.
You missed
because
one.
Because it refutes all of their stuff.
You missed one, actually. And we don't want to get into this, but Brother Tony and I written a lot about this. Because you know who you kind of smell behind all this sometimes? Smell. I don't want to point fingers. The Freemasons.
Who are the Freemasons?
I'm serious. It sounds bizarre.
That makes sense. That makes a lot of sense.
Well, they all swear on the Bible, all the Masons, so they're still Abrahamic.
It's a ritual.
They were going to do one of the most prominent ritual ever made with the Great Pyramid in modern times on the night of the millennium. Zahi Hawass was going to place a golden capsule on top of the Great Pyramid, and they were going to project the image of a nine. What is this? What's this image? It's the image of the supreme being of the Masonic order. Look at it on your dollar. They were going to do it. And people like me and my co-author Ahmed Osman, I'm writing a book about this, we went to the papers and we stopped it because they were going to advertise these symbols. They were creating strange symbols and they were going to use the Great Pyramid. And there's a game going on. I don't want to get into that because we're moving into different eras. But it's not just history, as you can see. There has been a game to prevent the truth, to prevent knowledge, and to prevent those who do speak it. I'm not a pyramidologist. I'm not a ufologist. I have a higher national diploma in construction. I have a postgraduate in European marketing. I speak 6 languages. Do you see a charlatan here? I'm a bit sort of passionate, but hey, that's the problem. That's the problem they have. Oops. Like John West said, they're not fighting against prophets now. They're fighting against prophets with firepower, TV, media. We go there. We want to bring all this out because that's when they're going to listen and get off their chains and their ivory towers. We want to bring it out in the open. Don't fight it in academic journals, in Scientific American. Who needs Scientific American? Fight it outside. Come, make our day. And you're only going to come out, believe me, when you put it on TV. And not just any TV. You want it on NBC, you want it on ABC, you want it on BBC. Not History Channel, Discovery Channel, who puts any old rubbish. That's where you want it, for people at the back. That's the game, and they've got people who know how to do this. They're in trouble. When John West and Robert Schock brought out The Age of the Sphinx on TV in 1993, look what happened. The whole world got excited. And what did they try and do? They're charlatans, they're idiots, they don't know what they're talking. Schock stood up in a conference at the AAA, the geological conference, and he presented his argument. One Egyptologist stood up and said, Mr. Schock, not one single Egyptologist agrees with you. And you know what he said? He says, I don't care if 1 million Egyptologists do not agree with me. Truth is not democratic.
Right, exactly.
If this is right, it is right. And I'm talking science. You have to deal with science. Enough of this blah, blah, blah. Yeah, sorry. I'm getting heated up. I love this. Love this talk. We have time. Come, Brother Tony. We're going to go. Why don't you go to school and learn hieroglyphics? We're having tea, by the way. We're friends of those days. Why don't you go and learn hieroglyphics? And I said, Dr. Hawass, I will. If you go to school and learn astronomy.
Uh-huh.
Are you an astronomer? No, no, I'm not being cocky here, but the problem is this.
I don't mean to make a personal attack. I just ask a question because I want to learn the hieroglyph, and I was wondering maybe you could direct me to the, you know.
I agree with you, and it's true, and it's a good question. I come to invent the wheel all the time. Yeah.
Well, everybody can't be a master in so many fields.
Yeah. Believe me, there's 5 years of study behind this. I mean, you know, you're hearing it in a 2-hour lecture, and there's a lot behind it.
Yeah.
I've written 8 books on this. But to answer your first question, if I remember it well, is it's true that there is mention by many late chroniclers, the Greeks and the Arabs.
The Arabs are the ones who took it away, I think.
Well, the Arabs somehow say it was full of inscriptions, and the Greeks seem to say the same thing. Then the pyramid was stripped of its outer casing, and they built Cairo with it. Arab times. You actually see pyramid stones in the old Cairo. There is not one single inscription on any of these casing stones. Mm. Now, many of the things, the Arabs said that when they entered the Great Pyramid there was a green statue and I don't know what. We can't take this seriously. And besides, we don't have one single pyramid in any case that has inscription on the outside. And we have the father of Cheops. Mm. The father of Cheops in Dashur, who built the 2 Dashur pyramids. And the whole outer casing of the pyramid is there. Mm-hmm. There is not one single inscription. The 4th dynasty did not inscribe pyramids. Yeah. We have to go with the evidence. You know? Right. If you believe any ancient chronicle, particularly Arabs, believe me, then they say all sorts of stories. But however, your other question is the age of Taurus. Kind of.
Is that right?
And I tell you what, you brought out something that I didn't have time to deal with.
For a procession?
No. There is a marvelous story, because remember I said Hassanein Bey discovered, and now we know that the Egyptians went there, didn't discover it. The Egyptians knew this place and went there thousands of years before. But you read in all the books, Hassanein Bey discovered it. No. Because those who discovered before him were, they don't count. The savages. Columbus discovered a new world. Quite a new world. This is a very old world.
And he's still teaching that garbage.
I know. But coming to the point, we have inscriptions in a tomb in Aswan. And I have photographs, but I won't show them. I'm going to use the water for that. Where the governor of Aswan, under the reign of Pepi II, a pyramid pharaoh, whose pyramid is full of inscriptions. Pepi II, right? Who has his pyramid at Saqqara. Right? Pepi II gave instructions from Memphis, the pyramid area, to the governor of Aswan, called Harkuf, to go and meet the people of Yam, these people. And Harkuf does 4 expeditions. And he reports his expeditions on his tomb. They're there for you to read. And there is no doubt that he went there. Read the inscription in my book. It's amazing. He went there, and he tells us he went there. He tells us how many donkeys he took, how long it took him, and how he met the people of Yam, and how he was glad to meet his ancestors and all that. And the Egyptologists have ignored this again. They say, no, it was impossible for him to go. No, he took a route. He did go a bit of the desert, but he took a route and he went, in fact, to the Nile, because that's where we say Yam was. You know, this trying to prove things by authority. No, the evidence is there. You read it on my book, the full translation of Harkuf's statements. And when you read it, it's impossible that Egyptologists did not realize that the ancient Egyptians of the Pyramid Age were going there. And Mentuhotep is a follower of the 12th dynasty of the Pyramid Age, at the end of the Pyramid Age. And his name is there. And King Khufu's name, you've seen it. Look in the book, we have pictures. It's there, it's in King Khufu of the Great Pyramid. And now we're beginning to think that they went even before the Pyramid. Why? Because they knew their ancestors were there, and they made contact, and they would go. Now, because we read the Pyramid text correctly, they went on pilgrimage. Like the Irish here go to Ireland because they want to see their ancestors. And like you guys will go to Africa. That's what they did. And that's what they tell us. And that's what the Egyptologists say, it's a lot of mumbo jumbo. And this, where's my book? It says it's not. Because the evidence is that you win at this game. Listen, I've been at it for 25 years. You're not going to get them agreeing with you until you ram it down their throat. And you're going to ram it down with facts. Things they can touch. Things they can see. You remember Groucho Marx when he said, you believe what I'm telling you? What you're seeing with your own eyes? I'm not just telling you this, I'm showing you this. You can go and touch it yourself. Finito, nada, no more arguments. That's when you bring it to checkmate. And that is when, and I'm pleased to say, I'm running, I'm taking more of my time. Because when you're really going to do this properly, you're going to need a whole. Don't worry, I'm going to finish in 5 minutes. Here is my final point. Here it is. Finally, one senior Egyptologist. Anthropologists are coming out, no problem, they see it. Archaeoastronomers are coming out, they see it. Here is an archaeoastronomer, PhD. Geologists are coming out, they see it. Egyptologists still holding back. They don't want to change the books. But finally, one has come out. And you know what? She is the personal assistant of Dr. Hawass. Dr. Salima Ikram. And unfortunately, it's on my blog, her statement, she went on British television and said, not I think, not we think, the origins of the pharaonic civilization is by those people that were in the Sahara there, before. She said it on British television a month ago. And if you want to read the quote, when my blog is working, because it's blog that my webmaster put it, kind of went down, you can find the quote. Salima Ikram. Salima Ikram is the head of the mummy section at the Cairo Museum. She's a Pakistani educated in England, and she's now realized that I better move, and she said, I don't see my friend. And I showed her all this picture. And she is right. She's saying, we're not going to fight anymore what has been proved. It's like telling Galileo the earth is not round. They can't fight this. So, what do? They'd rather you think that we are telling aliens, we are telling this, and we are telling I don't know what, and we're pyramidologists, and we're charlatans. But now they're in house arrest. I'm going to stop, I'm losing my voice.
No,
thank you guys, really, I enjoyed it.